Well, let's pray. Father God, we ask that you bless my dear friend as he brings the word to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, it is a great joy to be with you all at Redeemer on this beautiful morning. In Comal County, which someone told me is like one of the fastest growing counties in the country. Wow, things have changed a lot. But I love Pentecost because Pentecost, unlike the other two great Christian holy days, Easter and Christmas, has not been commercialized yet. So we can actually still, as Christians, celebrate Pentecost and rejoice in the birth of the church. By the way, happy birthday, church. And we can rejoice in the gift of the Holy Spirit. And we don't have to be reminded of it when we go to Walmart because there's like a special aisle and candies and stuff that actually doesn't have to do with the biblical message of Pentecost. So first of all, most of you, if you're used to going to Anglican churches, then you know certain calls and responses like, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
See, you guys know these things. And did you know that we actually have part of the liturgy of Pentecost, which in Hebrew is called Shavuot, which means sevens, because seven sevens is 49 days. Pentecost is Greek for 50 days. So Easter plus 49 days, boom, 50, right? So we actually have the liturgy for Pentecost, and it's in the book of Deuteronomy in chapter 26. So I'm just going to read it. I, too, am getting old, so I have to take off my glasses. I remember thinking, like, my dad would, like, take off his glasses to look at the receipt at the restaurant. I'm like, Dad, come on, don't be so dramatic. No, he was not being dramatic. Then it shall be when you enter the land which the Lord your God gives you as an inheritance, and you possess it and live in it, that you shall take some of the first of all the produce of the ground which you bring in from your land, that the Lord your God gives you, and you shall put it in a basket, and go to the place where the Lord your God chooses to establish his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at the time and say to him, and this is the confession, it would be like saying the creed or saying the Lord's Prayer. It's something that every Israelite would know. I declare this day to the Lord my God that I have entered the land which the Lord swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. You shall answer and say before the Lord your God, my father was a wandering Aramean, and he went down to Egypt and sojourned there, few in number. But there he became a great, mighty, and populous nation. And the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us and imposed hard labor upon us. Then we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction and our toil and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, and with great terror and with signs of and wonders. And he brought us to this place and has given us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now behold, I have brought the first of the produce of the ground which you, O Lord, have given me. And you shall set the basket down before the priest. So that would have been a liturgy, a very ancient liturgy. Indeed, some scholars think that this sort of confession or formula is one of the oldest parts of the oral tradition of the Bible that we even have today. And I love what Deuteronomy 26 teaches us about Pentecost, because that is the Pentecost confession, is that it teaches us that we have a home. We have a home. Have you ever, like when you listen to music, just realized how many songs are about home and how many songs are also like kind of nostalgic, you know, my hometown, or I remember, you know, back when we were young, when we were innocent, and the idea of always wanting a place where you are accepted and where you fit in and where people know you, warts and all, and you are loved? Well, in Pentecost, we have a home. And this is part of the beauty of this passage that we find. They had been oppressed. They had cried out to God. They had been saved, and they had been given this land. And then from that land, they take the first fruits. Now, we're not usually very agricultural nowadays, but what are the first fruits? That means you get that harvest and you get that first part of the harvest, and you're not sure if the rest of the harvest is going to come in, but Pentecost is about taking that first part of the harvest and not saying, Well, you know, let me keep the first part for myself in case the rest of the harvest isn't very good. But then, when the rest of the harvest comes in, if it's good, then I'll take that to the Lord. It's a demonstration of faith. Because you don't know if the rest of the harvest is going to come in, you're going to take that first part of the harvest and take it to the Lord your God. And you're going to remember what God has done in the past. Now, we have a part of our Eucharistic prayer, and I know there are a couple of different Eucharistic prayers, but all of them have this. And it's called the anamnesis. And it usually says something like, Lord, you created us in love, and our first ancestors went astray throughout the centuries. You sent sages and prophets to call us to repentance, but we would not listen to your voice. Therefore, in the fullness of time, you sent your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to be the Savior of the world. Something like that. Based on the different liturgies, you're going to find different prayers. But that is a memorial. That's the same thing that they were doing at Pentecost. And that's what we're doing every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper. In Pentecost, we have a home. God has given us not a physical piece of land, but a home, a spiritual home for all of us. We also find a fascinating lesson about Pentecost from a reading from Genesis. Did any of you think about why we would have Genesis 11, the Tower of Babel story, and the Pentecost story together? The answer is that St. Luke, in the Pentecost story, he's telling it to us in a particular way so that we understand that Pentecost is the birth of a new humanity, and it is the reverse working of the Tower of Babel. In the Tower of Babel, they all begin together. They have one language, they are one people, and they say, let us not go out into all the world, which had been the original Great Commission, right? Cover the face of the earth. Be good stewards of it. Multiply. Be fruitful. And they're saying, how about not, right? How about we build a city, right? So you can have a wall, you got that security everybody wants, and you have a tower. And that tower, you know, it's kind of different the way that we picture the universe, but that tower, the idea is like if you built a high enough tower, you could get into the domain of God or the gods. You could get into heaven if you could just build it high enough. That's how they thought. And so they have one name, and they say, and let us make a name for ourselves. This concept in Hebrew culture of the name is so important. That's why God, when he wants to show that he has authority over someone, what does he do? He gives them a new name. Right? And then when he wants to share his authority with someone else, he lets them name some, like with Adam, right? He made all the animals, and then God says to Adam, you can name the animals. So this act of naming is very important. I remember from living in Israel for 5 years, if something good happened, a Muslim would say, Alhamdulillah, which means praise be to God. And if something good happened to an Arab Christian, they would say, Nashkur Allah, which means we thank God. Because, you know, they have to say something different than the Muslim, right? But then if something happened that was good to, like, a devout or observant Jew, they would say, Baruch Hashem, which means blessed be the name, Hashem. Because by then they had the tradition that they did not want to say the name of God. It was so holy. And we still have that left over in our translations of the Bible today. When we see Lord with L-O-R-D and it's in caps, that is the divine name of God. Which has been incorrectly translated as Jehovah. But anyway, well, that's a story for another time. In any case, this idea of the name is so important. But all these people, when we read Luke's version of the Tower of Babel, but backwards, we find that they are all together, and why? Because they are remembering the great deeds of God, like we just read in Deuteronomy 26. All those people who were there at Pentecost would have taken the first fruits to the temple and had to recite that exact phrase, or that exact confession, really, from Deuteronomy 26. And they're there to praise God, to remember the things that God had done, and they all have one language in common. Now, it's not totally clear. Some people think that the miracle of Pentecost is that people are speaking in languages that they don't know. Others say, no, the miracle is that people are understanding languages that they don't know. Either way, it's a great miracle what is going on in Pentecost. What does that teach us about our new home, the church? Well, first of all, we are the new humanity. We are God's plan for the salvation of the world. Not because we are better than other people, but because we have that Spirit of God, and because we are sent out by the Son of God. So we have a new language. We have a new identity that goes beyond ethnicities. Thank you very much for your fine reading of all those. The only one that's worse, yeah, this is clergy humor here. What's the only Bible reading that is less enviable than that one from the New Testament? It's the one in Revelation where you have all the walls are made of all these different obscure gemstones, yeah, like chrysolite and stuff that I don't even know what it is. But anyway, so good job with that one. Our identity is based on what? On the one Spirit. This is a profound theological truth. In Eastern Orthodox theology, one person said, the icon of the Father is the Son. This is what we find in the Gospel today, right? If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. The icon of the Father is the Son. And what is the icon of the Holy Spirit? The Church. The Church is the icon of the Holy Spirit. Do you want to know what the Holy Spirit actually looks like? Hang out with your local church, whether it's a new congregation, a new church plant meeting in a hotel room, or whether it is a big cathedral or like the basilica that Bishop Scott and y'all are going to build once you get an address. So it's a great thing. It is a great thing. We are the new humanity. And we are bringing to God the first fruits. And we see the first fruits of that world evangelization right there in Acts 2. Thousands came in. It's one of Peter's more brilliant moments when he says, guys, they're not drunk. It's like 9 in the morning. It's like, I'm like, Peter, good for you, man. You're doing better than you had before in the Gospels. But we see thousands of people coming to faith and being baptized. And that's the first fruits. We know that because these first fruits have come in, we know that the rest of the harvest is going to come in. We have faith that the rest of the harvest is going to come in. Another interesting thing is that the Jewish people to this day, they have a special book of the Bible that they read during Shavuot or Pentecost. And that is the book of Ruth, the book of Ruth. If you don't know the book of Ruth very well, go back and listen, or go read it, or listen, you can listen to it on YouTube. Ruth is a short book, it's 4 chapters long. Why would Ruth be connected to Pentecost? Because it is a book about fertility. It is a book about fertility. It begins, it actually is a joke in Hebrew, it says, in those days in Bethlehem, which means the house of bread, there was no bread. You don't get it if you don't know Hebrew, right? And then you start with this family, and they're not having kids, so they have to leave. They have to go to the pagan land of the Moabs. And then Ruth is married, and then everyone dies. And the land in the Holy Land, the good land that's supposed to be flowing with milk and honey, it was not. It was not producing anything. And then also the men die, and they don't have children, so you have a lack of the fertility of the land, a lack of the fertility of the people. But what saves them? Did you know in the book of Ruth there's no antagonist? It's not like Esther and, well, Jonah. Jonah is his own antagonist in the book of Jonah. But like Esther has a typical bad guy, and you know, a lot of the, or like Daniel, that's got like the bad guy in Nebuchadnezzar and so on. But Ruth doesn't actually have an antagonist. It just has bad circumstances. But how do they find a home, Ruth and Naomi? They find a home because they are together. Because they will not leave each other. They are weak. They don't have money. They don't have power. They don't have authority. They're the weakest people in society at that time. But they come back to the house of David. And they come back to the land. And because they are a new family, God blesses them. And God provides for them. And then the land becomes fertile again. And the family becomes fertile again. Because they had listened to God, and because they would not give up on each other. This is also part of the promise of Pentecost. We have one Spirit. That is what unites all of us. Even though we come from different ethnic groups, even though we have different languages and worship in different ways, we all are united by the one Spirit. I know it can be hard to look at the global church today and think, yes, in the same way that my spirit animates my body and my mind, it is the Holy Spirit of God that animates the church throughout the world today. But that is the promise. That is the promise. And also, brothers and sisters, to conclude, we have one meal. We have a God who feeds us. When is the last time that you actually fed someone? Who do you feed? You feed people who are like really little, like babies, or people who are really old and can no longer feed themselves. We're going to partake of the sacrament of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have a God who feeds us. We have a God who is our Father. No one else can say that. You know, Muslims can't say that. I was hanging out with a Muslim friend yesterday, or ex-Muslim, really. And I said, one of the things we talked about is like, God is our Father. In Islam, you cannot say that because it's too intimate. You can say God is your creator, God is your master, God is your Lord. And Christians would say, yes, those are also correct. But God is our Father. So brothers and sisters, let us rejoice in the promise of Pentecost. Let us rejoice that though we are many, we are one body, that though we have many languages, we are God's plan for the salvation of the world as we, like the people at Pentecost, take the word of God out to the people around us in the name of Jesus Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.